All right, so actually, what a conference to have Leonard as kind of an opening act to my talk. So this is going to be a kind of a general talk about system performance. With systems, I mean Linux systems, and to be more specific, it's basically about Linux servers. Before I start, a little bit about myself. I actually like computers a lot. I like them fast. And I've been lucky enough to always find employers who kind of provide me those. So I used to work for AMD in Dresden, which is about 2 hours south of where we are right now. And I was there when we had the first 1 GHz processor, or x86 processor, I should say. I was there when AMD introduced the x86 46-bit extensions. That was quite an interesting time. And since 5.5 years, I'm now with Amazon. And what we do in Dresden is basically all the kernel and hypervisors that Amazon runs on their servers. And I truly can tell you those are a lot. And the kernel and hypervisors is coming from a group that has multiple offices, but a big one is in Dresden. I promised to put this up, so we are hiring. If you're interested in this, have a look or talk to us. Several people here. All right, but for the talk. So I agree the title is a little silly, because what does it really mean to be fast? That guy here, he was fast. So about 2 weeks ago in Berlin, there was a marathon, and the guy ran it in a little bit over 2 hours, so 2 hours, 1 minute or so, cut a new world record. And an interesting thing there is, you know, you have one number and you can compare them, and that's really it. You know, you say go and you measure wall clock time, and when the guy comes back in after the 42 kilometers, you have a number and you can compare those things. Computer systems, unfortunately, well, not unfortunately, but they are way more complex than that, and there are way more things you can measure. So let's have a look how a desktop is presenting you basically an idea of how fast it is. So GNOME has this system monitor, they call it, and on top you see CPU usage over time, you see memory usage and network usage over time. I mean, not a big surprise, but I probably would also add your hard drive. That's also an interesting number to see how much disk IO you have. I guess most of you will SSH into a server and run something like TOP or HTOP, which gives you a little bit more information. One of the numbers you probably cannot really read here is load. I remember back at the days at AMD, so I basically started in the IT infrastructure team there, and we had a weekly ops meeting for database servers and all those things. And one of the numbers we always looked at was load, and I think every other week or so there started a big discussion what this figure actually means and if it's useful to look at it or not. And we repeated this over and over again, and that is basically the slide is for my coworkers. So from the documentation in the file that is implemented, it basically is the number of running processes plus the number of uninterruptible processes in the run queue of the Linux kernel. And since this number goes up and down like crazy, you want to have an average over 1.5 and 15 minutes, and that was an exponential decay. It's totally interesting to look of the to check out the history of, you know, where load actually came from. And here's a quote from the guy, Matthias Ulrichs, who actually added this uninterruptible processes, which at the time mainly meant Disk.io. And you can read all of that in a blog post from Brandon Gregg, who is a hero when it comes to performance measurements, but I will quote him a couple of times in this talk. The thing to remember is load is a very good indicator for humans to look at a system and see what it's doing. But if you start to think about it for longer than 10 seconds, what this really means, and if this is actually telling you anything, then look for something else. Before we dive into all of that a little bit deeper, I'd like to come to a common understanding of some statistics and chart types. So the first thing is the mean value versus the median. Mean basically means you have a bunch of numbers and build the sum of this and divide by the count of those. Median is you line them all up, order them, and then pick the one in the middle. Interestingly, the median is the one you should choose for performance analysis in many cases, or probably most cases, because it's way more robust. You will see that in a second. Another thing you should be familiar with, because that is extremely helpful, is things like mean, standard deviation, percentile, so that is probably probability density function of the normal distribution. Percentile basically means, again, you order all your measurements in a long row, order them by size or by number, and then you would have the 50% percentile right in the middle. For this normal distribution, that the mean and the median are exactly at the same point, right in the middle, and well, at 2 sigma you have the 79 dot whatever percentile, and that means that basically, you know, all your measurements or that 97% of your measurements are below this number. So why is that important? Just imagine you measure over time some API, some web API, you know, which you query, and what you're interested in, how long does it take to get a response latency for that thing. The green thing is the median, and you see that this number is pretty robust, right? So if you are actually, if you want to eliminate outliers from your matrix, that is really the thing to use. The light blue one is the mean value, where you see this is indicating a little bit. And if you serve this service to real users, you're probably interested in the percentile, that I think is the 95 percentile here. And you really see how this goes up. And that still means that 5% of your users have a worse experience at this point, which is not good. All right, another thing to always keep in mind when you do performance measurements is caches. So here's a guy who measured latency, I believe, for his hard drive. And what you see is in this chart, in this histogram here, it goes up, then it goes down, and then it goes up again. And well, by the title, you probably will have guessed. Here, you basically measure cache. So it might be you really measure just access to memory here, where that probably is where your system has to really scrape things off the hard drive. And so, of course, the first comment on this blog was to use ODirect or Direct.io to basically bypass the cache. For latency, yeah, I was expecting that this is hard to read here. Things to keep in mind. So if you wanted to check that out, there are many more examples on this GIST. If you say that one CPU cycle, which takes about 0.3 nanoseconds, would be 1 second, right? Then a level 3 access, cache access, would be some like 43 seconds, which is quite some time compared to L1 cache access, which is 3 seconds. However, if you go further and you talk to real memory, or you have to talk to real memory, that already would be 6 minutes. I mean, you can read all of that here, but another number, a TCP retransmit, which 1 to 3 seconds in this perspective would already be something like 100 years, and a physical system reboot, let's say this takes 5 minutes, and that's why I put this up here. That means at this time, if you would take this time back in the world history, that was when the Sahara still was an ocean. So that is something I think you should remember from time to time, that really caches are a very good idea. And well, if you have too much network I/O, that already adds a lot of latency. So I took this table out of this book. To be honest with you, you should be reading this book and not listening to me. Ben Gregg is really one of the guys to listen to. I truly highly recommend this book. I would know a good place where to order it, but I leave that to you. We have seen a couple of chart types already. I had this line chart, I had the histogram, bar charts. This has nothing to do with computers, but I wanted to introduce the concept of those scatter plots. So this is basically how much people pay in a restaurant for their bill. How much tip people give in a restaurant, depending on the price of the bill and of the gender. So what you see, if you go out for lunch, that's pretty much the same. So in this chart, you have multiple dimensions. You have the gender, you have the tip, of course, the total bill, and you see those clusters of information. And interestingly, when it comes to dinner, then male customers tend to give way more tip than female ones. I don't know why. Another chart type, which is very, very informative for humans, those are heat maps. What you basically see is, I mean, down here is a heat map for network latency, where at some point a bandwidth limitation kicks in, and then you see, you know, how the latency is distributed for your packets, and that is not something a single number could kind of tell you, or a distribution. Another thing that also Brandon pushes quite a lot are flame graphs. They also are extremely informative of understanding what goes on in your system. Right. Now I'd like to come back to more the categories we were at before. That's CPU, memory, disk I/O, network I/O. And let's start with CPU performance. So basically the question is, how long does a computational task take? I was asking one of our principal engineers how he would put this in 3 bullet points for a slide, and his answer was, it all depends. But it's true. It really depends on the architecture. So my first computer had a Z80 CPU in there. That was something you could easily understand. Modern computers or modern CPUs are quite complex systems. It also depends on caches, as we saw before, memory latency, IPC, so that is instructions per cycle, clock speed, and if you are after integer or a floating point performance. So in the good old days, clock speed was the thing. I already mentioned we had the 1 gigahertz, and then it was 2 and 3, and then people found out, oh, actually, we cannot scale this up to infinity. Then they started to add more cores and stuff. But of course, if you have an application which is bound to one core, then the other 71 you saw before are kind of idle. So the answer really is, it's a mix of different micro benchmarks you would need to run to answer this question, and this really comes down to your workload or to your application to really say if you have the right CPU performance or not. There are standardized ways like spec CPU, but this costs money to use. A free benchmarking or stressing tool I find extremely valuable is StressNG. So by now they have some like 70 CPU specific, they call this stressors. Basically it's micro benchmarks. And the tool lets you say, okay, I want to have everything you consider to be a CPU benchmark or a CPU stressor and a CPU cache stressor. Run this for a minute and just dump the matrix. And then you get a long, long table like this. They call actually the result BOGO ops, which is not a bad name because you never know really what that number at the end of the day means, but you can compare those numbers between different CPUs and different architectures. And actually the art at the end is to pick the right ones out of those and combine them in the right way. And yeah, that is basically what the Spec Consortium does with Spec CPU. Even though you have to be careful that you use the same config if you want to compare two spec CPU runs with each other. So I mentioned StressNG. Overall, they have now about 200 of those stressors. They hit various subsystems like Block.io for network. You can do things like thrashing caches, so basically invalidating them. They also target certain kernel interfaces, and yeah, it's also a very good tool to check if your system is robust. Right, let's get to Block.io. The question here is, we want to read and write files. They are split into blocks in different sizes. And one of the applications would be to read a long, long sequential block or blocks of, a big file, basically. You want to get this off your hard drive. Where another type of an application probably requires quick, random access, and then seek time is a big thing. So like you will see in the others, the trade-off always is high throughput versus low latency. A few more parameters one has to understand when we talk about Block.io. So IOPS are input-output operations per second. Or people call it I/O capacity, and sometimes you have manufacturers that come up with a big IOPS number, and they want to impress you with that. it's not always the truth to what your block devices they actually are capable of. Another parameter to look at is queue depth. That basically means how many I/O operations can be in flight or can be queued at a certain time, or at the same time, I should say. And latency basically means how long does this I/O operation take. So, and when you have a big queue depth and you basically get tons of IOPS, but it doesn't mean that your latency is actually where it should be for your application. Let's assume that your application needs a very, very low latency. So, and you have a little formula how to calculate your IOPS. That is a nice visualization of the Linux storage system I found. So basically up here is file systems and caches. So that is the thing where I can bypass that. And you have the whole block layer and down here your devices. And when you benchmark block I/O, that is also something to have in the back of your head. There are many, many tools to measure all those parameters. The one I find extremely useful, well, the one which I use the most is FIO. It stands for Flexible I/O Mapper. And it's actually from the kernel maintainer that is in charge of this block I/O layer in the Linux kernel. To get started with it, I recommend to look at the examples that come with it. There are even examples how you can measure S3. So it's capable of many things, as you will see over the next couple of slides. It also can do even HTTP requests. So this is a default command. So name is basically the file on the disk we use to write. We say we want to have a random read-write benchmark. We want to have direct I/O, so we don't want to measure memory performance in terms of caches. We use the I/O engine libAIO. The block size is 1 megabyte. The mix for random read-write is that we want to have 75% read and 25% write, which is usually a pretty good mix. The size of this file here we create for writing is 1 gig. We want to have group reporting, I mean, even though it doesn't fit on one slide, the output. And I/O depths of 4 means we have 4 I/O operations in flight, but this is not what on the storage controller is. And we want to have 2 jobs in parallel. So, and then you get tons of output. There are blog articles that discuss those. I also have to warn you that with newer versions of FIO, that from time to time changes. If you want to pass that, don't. FIO can output all of that in, for instance, JSON and other file formats. You can easily pass later on. But what you get here is basically the read IOPS are, I did it like this, are 166, so I/O operations per second. That gives us a bandwidth of 166 megabytes. Another thing where I may be confused a little bit is he gives you this SLAT, CLAT, and LAT. So those are latency for submission and completion. Another thing you should be aware of, I know it's probably hard to read, always look at the units here, because sometimes you can get confused why those numbers don't add up, and then you see it's all about the units. You also get percentiles. in your output, and yeah, there's tons of more information. It even reports your page faults. So whenever you say major page faults, then it's probably something else cropped. Network. We basically have the same problem, but this time we call it transmit and receive. So receive is reading, transmit writing to the network. We have the same things. It might be we, you know, want to stream this talk to the internet, then we are all about throughput. It might mean we want to do a VoIP call over the internet. Then latency is a big issue. So basically round trip time. And we have the problem that networks usually are unreliable. So if you transport something over the internet, there's no guarantee that your packets arrive. Yeah, I showed you this kind of picture before. It's actually done with FIO, so FIO also can target client server, and then it's, you know, the same thing. We measure I/O, and if you take the latency for each packet that gets transferred and use something like matplotlib, in that case you can get this very nice heat map charts where you can try to understand what's going on for many hours. So if you know what's going on here, so we again kick in bandwidth limitation, and then at some point those two spread out here. So far I haven't found out what this means. Right, I said one of the challenges is that you have packet loss and packet corruptions and retransmits and all those things. There's a nice module in the Linux kernel called NetDM. And you probably would put this in between your client and servers where you measure your network performance, and you can with three lines introduce those errors at this point. So basically, you load it into kernel, to your root QDisk, you add it, and then you do things like, I want to have a delay introduced between 50 and 10 milliseconds. I want to have them normally distributed. I want to have 0.1% corruption, and I want to have 0.1% packet loss. And yeah, that's what you get. So basically, the latency and stuff is much more spread out. So for memory, again, it's the same thing, read-write. So we are interested in throughput. We are interested in latency. We have to make sure to not measure cache performance. Other things to keep in mind are page faults or how you actually access your memory. So if you have Numa nodes, keep that in mind to really measure the thing you want to. One option, of course, is again StressNG. So this time we use the class memory and VM. Again, that takes time to find the right stresses for your workload. There are other benchmarks, like this one called XMEM, mainly developed by Microsoft, but it's open source, which basically has all the features you might be interested in. And also supports basically many different platforms. So in case you're interested in ARM, XMEM serves the purpose. Right, some other performance measurement tools I find useful, and that came to my mind when I made the slides. First of all, again, I'd like to stress Brandon's blog. So there are tons of tools like, I don't know really where to start. Perf is a very important one, S-Trace, IOTOP, BlockTrace, IOSTAT. There's a great talk by Brandon himself, where you find a link on brandgreg.com/linuxperf.html. Totally worth to spend this hour. And he basically goes over many of those tools here and explains in which cases they are useful. Another one I found extremely helpful is SysJitter. So sometimes you have the problem that, maybe I explain first what SysJitter does. So it's basically running a thread on each CPU of your system, and it measures the time the thread gets stopped. And this gives you a very good measure of, you know, how much jitter is introduced in your system. Of course, you should run this on an idle system because otherwise it doesn't mean much. But that is a very good tool to measure that and to see if something strange is going on in your system. And yeah, in that case, it ran over 4 CPUs that I'm, and you have percentiles and everything. And here you see the total interruption time in percent. So the system, first of all, looks pretty even, and also looks pretty much okay. And then you have those tools that more or less try to do everything. So those are more frameworks. One of them is Sysbench. So if you don't want to get into details of finding out what are the best CPU micro benchmarks and stuff, then maybe Sysbench or something similar is good. So they have one number you get for CPU, one for memory, and other things. They also have a MySQL database benchmark. And you can add your own, and I'm not sure if they provide charting there. But this gets your job done pretty quickly. Another one is HPCC. I especially mentioned that for the stream memory benchmarks. They're pretty useful. I like their chart where they basically have the numbers of all the benchmarks they support, and then you get the circle, which is good, and you know, you get this weird distributions where one benchmark is good and then another one is not. PerfKit is something from Google, where they basically wanted to provide a framework where you can benchmark different cloud providers. Even if you're not interested in cloud computing, but you know, have your own servers, they have a long list of benchmarks that make sense. And the other good thing is they already come pre-configured, so you know which parameters are a good pick. And of course, you can run those things individually. Another one, probably the largest one, is the Phoronix test suite. They really have a large collection of benchmarks and tests. In there, it's a framework. You will see on their webpage, they sometimes try to attract readers in kind of a clickbait way. A big warning: make sure you do not upload your test results to the Phoronix servers. It is said that some companies did this accidentally with products they didn't even have shipped. That's probably not really what you want. I'd like to close my talk with a case study I found couple of days ago. So the headline is running a database server on EC2, your clock could be slowing it down. So they obviously also had the performance problem, and they did a long analysis, and they figured that they were using a clock source, which the Xen clock source, which required a syscall, and that totally slowed them down. So sure, use TSC, where you don't have to execute a syscall to get the time. Thing I want to say with that is it might be that you really try to chase down performance bottlenecks, and then it's something completely different. So last slide. Understand your systems and bottlenecks. Monitor continuously and also benchmark from time to time. All right, thank you.